to get on a plane, come out here and talk to us, or does that carry a threat for you?
Actually, it was easier. The problem is going back.
He's trying for your job, Thida. He wants to be a comedian.
No, actually, last year I returned from a trip from South Africa and I was barred from entering the country. And then I asked, which country will take me now that you are preventing me from entering? You can arrest me, but it's unconstitutional for you not to let me come back. They said, no, there is a serious problem here. And what kind of thing have you done against the government to deserve that punishment? And I said, I don't know. Well, to cut it short, in the end, the officials issued a statement saying that there was a drug lord being wanted by the Interpol, and he had the same name as me. And that's why they were preventing me from entering the country.
Well, look, on one occasion, just one occasion, I think you received a 40-day detention without charge, during which you were denied water and food for many days. I'm really intrigued what your motivation is. Why do you keep doing it?
Let me tell you first this story. I was arrested as a prisoner of war, not as a journalist, and locked in this cell, no food, no water. And then one Lebanese prisoner called Fidel said, you know, went up to my cell and said, brother, here there is no guerrillas, there's nothing, we all here are prisoners, and how can I help you? And I said, well, can you deliver a message to the outside? I said, yes. And then the message was that I was going on a hunger strike. So the following day, the prison warden showed up and the guard with a tray with orange juice, and they knew already I was a vegetarian, and said, you're a liar. You know, I'm the one who's preventing you, forbidding you to have food and water. What kind of ethics do you have to say that? And I said, well, go to the public and tell that. And from that day, I said, you know what? Now I'm going to go on a hunger strike to make you feel the pain. And for 14 days, I was on a hunger strike. But the lesson I learned with that experience is that the prisoners themselves felt they needed to help me because I was put in that jail as a hiding place. My family didn't know where I was. No one knew. And once they discovered I was a journalist, they said, once you get out of here, you will tell our stories. And that's how basically I became known as a human rights defender, which was not my intention in the first place. I wanted to write poetry.
So going back to the young Rafael, was there a moment, an incident where you decided, I want to spend my life doing this? Was it as a child or an adult?
I never really wanted this kind of life. As a child, I wanted to be a priest because when I went to the school for the first time under Marxism-Leninism, we had to sing a song, I will die with the weapons of war in my hands, a grenade will be my casket, and my burial will be in a patrol. So I went back home and told my mother I never want to go back to school because I don't want to die. And then she would take me to church. I said, I want to be a priest. Because when you go to church, even Jesus who died, he lived again. So that's why I wanted to be a priest.
I could see that coming. And you laugh and you're funny. But what you do is quite scary, isn't it?
It's a privilege to serve. And as a citizen.
Who are you serving?
My country, my people, and above all, being a good citizen.
Yeah, if your country's
and
ruler.
And that's something I owe to myself.
If your country's ruler walked in here and saw you, how would that conversation go? He must hate you with a vengeance.
He knows I'm here because days ago I wrote an open letter to him about the State of the Union address and basically saying, you know, Mr. President, people think you oppress us, but they're wrong. Because we oppress ourselves, you know. Because we let you abuse us. We're 24 million and you're one individual.
Yeah.
So how can that be? And it takes social awareness. And it takes a kind of information to enable people to make the right decisions.
Yes.
And when we look at Africa, there is this withdrawal from good citizens that have let dictators resurface. And you have more problems in Africa today than you had a few years ago, with more dictators coming in and more corrupt leaders, because people are allowing them to behave that way.
So where do you get your support from?
You see, I grew up reading comics. And with the comics, you get, because under Marxism-Leninism, we didn't have access to Western literature except the comics. And in the comics, you always find these individuals with these strange powers that basically suck the powers out of the others.
Yeah.
So it's basically what you do in a situation where you have no means of working. Essentially, you tap into the very same regime that is trying to oppress you, and you make it work for you. Like, I will give you an example. Once I was just by my gate, and there was a minister in front of my gate giving directions to on the electoral process, to rig the process. And I just went back to my living room and wrote the story. So didn't need to leave my house. He was right there in front of my gate delivering the message, because apparently he thought no one lived there or no one was in the house.
But do you have support from other journalists?
Yes, I do, but I mostly do from members of the regime.
Yes.
Because they understand as well. Once one offered me a $150 bottle of wine and said, well, you are a human rights defender, and remember, when our time comes to need legal defense, you know, you're a human rights defender for everyone.
What did you do with the bottle of wine?
We drank it together because I said, okay, otherwise you'll take it home, so we might as well just drink it.
So what tools would you like to do your job today better? How can you be helped, or how can the international community help you?
You touched a very important point. There is more support from the international community for dictators and corrupt leaders, because those are the ones who control the resources and park it in the West. So there has to be a reversal. There has to be more support for individuals like myself. And I don't need much. For instance, I work out of my own kitchen. So if I could have better appliances in my kitchen, I'm sure I would do my work much better.
You go and sit over there. Go and sit over there. Ladies and gentlemen, Rafael. Thank you.
Just take it.
And now we're going to be joined by Thida, a Burmese surgeon, writer and political commentator and a human rights activist. In 1993, Thida was sentenced to 20 years in prison, of which she served 5.5 years for her activism. And ever since that release, she's monitored and written on events in Burma, and with the lifting of the military regime, now heads PEN International Myanmar Centre. Thida, welcome to Brisbane. Welcome to Australia.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I think you were born into a middle-class family, an accountant, an English teacher, your parents. Tell us about the young Thida.
Well, I was so lucky to have my parents and my grandpa and my grandma too, because they gave me sort of the freedom. And I was always thinking of to keep my own authority since I was young, and my parents, especially my father, he always support me. And even though I wanted to become a medical doctor, but he was not happy becoming a medical doctor at that time. He was a little bit different from the other parents, you know. Yeah, he was thinking of having a pure scientist. It's indeed pretty much needed for the country, for the benefit of the country. So I think the spirits of being a good citizen, it's inherited from him, and I was so lucky to have him.
So you became involved in a way in politics in the mid-1980s. How did that come about?
Well, you know, I was always thinking of going to be a good citizen for my country and for my people. And in 1988, there was, at that time, by that time, I was already being recognized as a short story writer, and most of my short stories are all about the voiceless and powerless people, because I vividly seen the poverty of the society, and I always thinking, how can I help them?
Yes.
So in 88, there was a chance for me to go against the dictatorship, and there will be the solution for the society. So I did it.
What do you mean you went against? What did you do?
You know, I joined the demonstration, and I keep doing it. It's kind of the activism against the military regime throughout.
And on that day in 1998, you were arrested and you were sentenced to 20 years jail. And I think the charge was endangering public tranquility, having contact with unlawful associations and distributing unlawful literature. Tell us about that day.
You know, in 1990, there was elections, and National League for Democracy, led by Aung San Suu Kyi, won the majority of seats, but yes, instead of transferring the power, the military regime decided to having a national convention in 1993 to draw the draft of the constitution, and it was out of the process, and I was against that. So because of that, I was sentenced to 20 years imprisonment.
And you served till 1999,
yes,
I think. And I read where you actually came out and you thanked your jailers. What was that about?
Well, you know, I never think I was a victim, and I was a witness. So I was always hoping to have my own prison memoir, and this is going to be my testimonial. So I was so happy. First of all, when the judges said 20 years imprisonment, I was a little bit happy because I have my chance to write my own prison memoir.
Were your parents a little bit happy?
They were not, you know. But they accepted and they support me because we don't have any, not many choice to face. Yeah. And at least someone needs to be the witness.
You love writing. You're a writer through and through, and a beautiful writer. How powerful is the pen in influencing public opinion and forging change?
You know, there was almost no journalism whatsoever during the socialist government. So this is the literature, especially short story, is kind of the medium or the platform for,
yeah,
not only giving the message, but also disseminating the information, some sort of that. That's why I think the literature and writing is so much, compared to the journalism, I think the literature itself is more deep enough into the heart of the society. If you really want to learn about the society, it's not just through journalism, it's, yeah, through literature. So literature ever was very much important for me to learn about the society.
You're an activist, Aung San Suu Kyi, a politician. Is one more powerful than the other, do you think?
Well, indeed, I don't want to be named either as activist or politician.
You
indeed,
want to be a writer.
I just want to be an independent good citizen. That's the most privileged title for me, and I was always wondering how I can be helpful for my society and my people.
So what about then young activists in Burma now? How do you engage them in a new landscape?
Well, I always tell them that the young population, and I want to rely on you. So I always thinking they are the promising population of the country. So we don't simply lead them, and we want them to lead the country.
And is that happening?
It's not that happening, but I always thinking of helping them to lead their life themselves or to lead the society. So that's the way. I always believe the senior population, the senior generations, never ever think we are the leaders for the, yeah, younger generation. And not in that sense. I think every single people should have the ability to lead themselves, and we just need to encourage every single one.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Thida. Thank you, Thida. And now let me introduce our next guest, who is in the unusual position, I guess, of being one of the most recognisable journalists in Australia without actually having done much work in this country for most of the past 25 years. I'm talking, of course, of Peter Greste, who was working, who has worked for a string of organisations, CNN, Reuters, BBC, and, of course, Al Jazeera. Then late in 2013, as we all know, Egyptian security agents arrested Peter and two other Al Jazeera English journalists, accusing them of news reporting that was damaging to national security. And he was jailed for 400 days. Hello. Are you getting used yet? Are you getting used to all this being a celebrity, being the news rather than behind the news?
I hate that term, celebrity. It just drives me nuts. I mean, it's very flattering, of course, to be considered as a celebrity, but I've often said that I think that I've become well-known more because of what was done to us more than anything that we did. I mean, I'm not saying that we were completely mute in this whole affair, but it would never have happened. I wouldn't be in this position if it weren't for the Egyptians. So in a lot of ways, I've got a lot to thank the authorities
for. Just like your
jealous. Yes, exactly, yeah. So that was very good for me.
You have a fabulous smile, doesn't it? It lights up a room, but I suspect it makes light or hides the heartache of what you went through. Tell me about the worst day.
Gosh, I mean, let me deal with the first assumption, and that's really that I didn't feel the heartache in the sense that you're talking about. It was a tough experience. I would never want to go through that ever again, and I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy. But it became the thing that really drove this was, for me, or the way that I got through it, was not by taking it personally. I felt that I was representative of something much bigger, that we were there as proxies for all journalists in Egypt. And so in that sense, we were stand-ins for much bigger principles, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and some fundamental principles of democracy, the public's right to know. And so in that respect, I never felt the heartache in the sense that I was being punished.
But sitting there in jail, you on those long days, and you didn't know that you would get out or when you'd get out. You're not sitting there thinking, I'm doing this for the freedom of the press and the people's...
Well, actually, yes. I mean, it's... And I don't mean that in any kind of pious sense. It's just that I looked at this really hard to try and figure out how on earth we'd found ourselves in prison when the gap between what we were accused of doing, and you just mentioned the charges earlier, and what we actually did, and it was so wide that there was no correlation whatsoever between those two things.
Yes.
And the only thing I could think of, the only reason I could think of that we were there was because the authorities wanted to send a clear and unequivocal message to journalists everywhere that you will not speak to the Brotherhood. And they came after us because we were politically convenient. And so I always felt, and yeah, I mean, I had moments of bitterness and anger, real fury, but I never felt that it was about anything that I had done personally. And so I never took it as a personal affront.
What about leaving your colleagues behind when you were walking out knowing that they were remaining in prison? What was actually going through your head?
Well, real contradictions of emotions, contradictory emotions. The first thing was that we always knew that that was a possibility.
Yeah.
And we talked about it. You know, one of the things in prison, and I'm sure a lot of the other panelists here will agree with me, that even though you might worry that people you leave behind are envious, the thing is that every time someone walks out of prison, you feel a little bit freer in your own heart.
Yeah.
I always felt that. There are a few times when people were released, and it was such a wonderful feeling for them, and it really affected me. And so we all recognize that if one of us was being released, there is no way that those who are left behind would ever, ever want that person to spend another minute or a second in prison. But the other thing was that we also recognized that to stay behind, to try and dig your heels in, to refuse to go would be a fool's errand, because frankly, the released prisoner, the one of us who was released, would be a far more powerful advocate for the rest of us.
And that's proved to be the case.
Well, that's what we did, yes.
Yeah. I fell in love with your parents during that time, and I think they're in our audience today, are they?
They are in the audience.
Just wonderful to have them here. Yeah. Um, But your mum says in your book that looking back, it almost seems that life had prepared us for some of the trials ahead. Just tell us about their role.
Well, for a start, they were absolutely extraordinary. If the truth be known, I was nothing more than a mute lump stuck inside a cage in Egypt. It was my parents, my family, that took that fairly empathetic image, of course, but made it sympathetic. It was my parents, my brothers, that the nation fell in love with, that they empathized with, that they recognized and felt for. And so without them, I would still be in prison. I'm absolutely convinced of that. The preparation that Mum speaks of, I think in lots of ways, has to do with, I mean, my own experience as a reporter, of course, prepared me for perhaps that kind of moment. I'd obviously put my parents through, God knows, untold moments of grief when I wandered off to front lines around the world. I remember my first moment was when I called them just after I'd been out of Sarajevo in Yugoslavia during the siege, thinking that I'd managed to sort of sneak in and sneak out without them actually knowing, until Mum screamed at me, bellowing at me, wondering how the hell I'd managed to get a report out on the ABC radio a couple of days earlier from the front lines of Sarajevo. So, you know, they'd already been aware that my father, of course, had a long period as a refugee from during the Second World War. And so I guess all of these things combine in ways that you don't really anticipate.
I know in Australia it's very different, but we've seen a political debate about how much freedom of speech or press freedom is warranted. Do you think that freedom of speech is more broadly under threat around the world?
Yeah, I do, and I think it's also under threat here in Australia as well. In particular, I think, and perhaps if there's one theme that unites a lot of us up here, it's the way that governments have used terrorism, the war on terror, as a way of tightening down or clamping down on freedom of speech and freedom of the press in particular. The problem with the war on terror is that it's such an indefinable term that it means whatever anybody wants it to mean. It's a really slippery thing, very, very difficult to pin down. We all use the term and we all think we know what it means, but the war on terror means something very different to a villager sitting in, say, Afghanistan than it does to those of us sitting in this auditorium here in Brisbane. And it means something else to a politician sitting in Washington.
Yeah.
And so, in our case, what happened was that the government, we were talking in Egypt to the political party that had been in power previously, that had been ousted from power 6 months earlier. Under normal circumstances, they'd be considered to be the opposition.
Yeah.
Turns out they were the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Egyptian authorities had accused them of acts of terrorism. And so they redefined terrorism to include the opposition. Now, I'm not suggesting that the Brotherhood had no influence over some of the acts of terror, but clearly at the time they were the largest and most important political force in Egypt outside the government itself. And so, you know, what we're seeing here in Australia and all over the world is governments using terrorism, using the war on terror as an excuse to introduce all sorts of draconian legislation, which I think dramatically and very seriously limits the work that the press is trying to do. And as we heard earlier from the Amnesty International speaker, she pointed out that things happen in dark places. Bad things happen in dark places. Now, what the Australian government has done is stopped journalists from visiting places like Nauru.
Yeah.
You know, it's the only way you can get in is if you sneak. There are a few fairly sympathetic reporters who've been allowed to go, but for the most part, nobody has been able to get in.
And so they're chipping away at that freedom.
And exactly. They're chipping away at freedom. They're creating dark places. There are several other tranches of legislation that we could go through, but what it does, the collective impact, is to make it harder for journalists to interrogate issues around national security.
Yeah.
And that, I think, is a very dangerous thing.
All right, I think we might come back to that in our conversation in just a moment. But everything you've been through, personally, how has it changed you and the way you see people?
You know, a lot of people expect me to be very cynical. But I feel quite the opposite. If anything, what this experience has done has given me enormous faith in the basic decency of human beings, of ordinary people. The day that we were convicted, our own jailers were in tears. These were ordinary guys who were basically public servants, who were hired to do a job. They were trapped. In a way, we came to think of them as much prisoners of the system as we were, because they were trapped in this pretty horrible place because they had to make money. And they were, there are a few of them that weren't particularly pleasant, but for the most part, they were just blokes trying to do a job. So many times in Egypt, I had people whispering to me, look, we're terribly sorry about this. Please forgive us. It's not our fault.
Yeah.
I've felt time and again that for every human rights abuse that I've reported on, I've found a dozen people who are prepared to open up their homes, to put their lives on the line, to investigate, to protect and defend.
Okay, one last question before we have our group discussion. In your book, your brother Andrew says that he remembered advice your dad liked to give in tough situations. When your day is not going well, your dad said, and you're feeling down, go and buy yourself a new suit. How many suits do you now own?
Not quite as many as my dad has.
I can only imagine. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Peter. And I'm happy to hashtag Integrity20, happy for you to tweet your questions, and we'll try and get through some of those as well. But we're talking about, riders under arrest, and you've disparately mentioned some of the charges you've faced, and so much comes down to language. Rafael, just run through the types of charges you've faced.
Last year, actually, I was on trial and I was convicted to 6 months in prison. And when I went to... First, to the interrogations, there were three charges against me. And on the day of my trial, the judge read 18 charges against me. And it can range from... just to give you an example, I went to try to see a trial of some young activists last year. And they didn't allow me in the courtroom. They just said, no, you, Rafael, you can't be here. Let's go home. So I went home. And then on the main television bulletin, news bulletin, state television, there was a statement that I tried to enter the court illegally. And there would be consequences for that. And I said, but I went to court. They said, go home. And I went home. How is this news? And how did I try to enter the court illegally when... the trials are public.
Yeah.
In my own case, I ended up even being convicted for a crime I was not even under the trial for.
And what were you convicted for? What was the sentence?
I wrote this book on exposing human rights abuses in the Diamond Areas, and I lodged a criminal complaint against the generals I exposed as being the culprits for those violations, as the owners of the private security companies that went around killing and torturing people in the Diamond Areas. And they're also the shareholders of the Diamond Company. But the charges reversed, so the Attorney General used my criminal complaint to charge me. And the book was published in Portugal. The general sued me in Portugal, and they lost the case in Portugal, because I was able to present evidence in Portugal. They sued me again in Angola, and I was convicted for writing the book, which had nothing to do with the trial I was under, because the trial had to do with the charges, with the criminal complaint I had lodged against the generals. And you ask me, why would I lodge a complaint against them? Because I thought, each time we tell the truth, we get sued. So why don't we try that first? We tell the truth and then we sue them for the wrongs they have done.
Rafael, were you charged? Were you accused of crimes around journalism or writing, or was it something else? Was it?
I was accused of defamation. I was accused of slander. I was accused of. I can't even explain, because just to give you an idea, I had all my bank accounts scrutinized by the Attorney General and all my trips. And I said, what do this have to do with the case? And they found $3,000, so that's all I had in my bank accounts. And there were 150 pages in this case of defamation which were related to my financial situation and my trips. So they didn't really have any evidence. That's the whole thing.
And language is an important thing here too in terms of what makes up the charges. And I think, Rafael, it's not an arrest. They've started using the terms, they've gathered individuals. So you've been gathered many times.
Yes. One of the times, actually, I was having lunch and my family asked me to go and buy tomatoes for the salad. And I ended up being held by the police. And later they issued a statement, said, no, we didn't arrest him. And actually the provincial commander of the police in the capital went to get me out of the police station. And when she got there, she said, how did this man get in here? And every police officer said, we don't know. And she said, but he's here at the police station. I see him here. How did he? So did he just walk in? Says, no, he came with a police officer, but the police officer left, so we don't know what he's doing here. So it gets to a point you can't really explain what is happening.
Yes.
Like just before coming here, I went on an investigative trip for the day, and I was stopped at 5 checkpoints. And on the last one, the police officer said, the traffic officer, I'll apprehend your car because you have a receipt for your car document. And I had the car document. Oh, because you cannot have the receipt and the document. I said, well, but when I went to get the document, they just handed it to me. They didn't get the receipt. So I kept it here. So no, this is very dodgy. So the car has to stay. So you never know what these authorities will come up with. But the fact is that quite often, because of these kinds of abuses they take, they will still have legitimacy. And I just heard the Angola's Speaker of Parliament speaking in Geneva that Angola is for the protection of human rights defenders. And they're really taking a strong stand on that. And they get a free ride for that.
Peter.
It's something that, I mean, that resonates a lot with what we experienced in Egypt, because the Egyptian constitution, which had just been drafted just before we were arrested, is very explicit about freedom of speech, freedom of the press. And whenever anybody accused the Egyptian authorities of locking up journalists, of attacking freedom of the press, but they'd say, look, nobody is in our prison for crimes of journalism.
Yeah.
You know, they pointed to us and says, no. They're not in there for their journalism. They're responsible for criminal acts, for acts of terrorism. They're in for terrorism, not for their reporting. And this is something that you see time and again. It's around the phrasing of the charges. Yeah. Nobody is arrested for their writing, but it's what that writing means. Defamation, for example.
Yeah, similarly, you know, I was sentenced. Indeed, the crime they told me is I read a periodical published outside of country. That's all my crime, indeed. Yeah, but there are several charges because I think the Martial Code, at that time we were facing the Martial Code, and the Martial Code has been sentenced several other people without having any reasons. So for me, altogether 11 people were sentenced to 20 years, but I never ever seen half of them in my life.
And Thida, we heard Peter and Rafael say that inside jail there was a certain amount of sympathy for them and their cause. Did you experience the same thing, or were they pretty tough on you in jail?
Even during the investigation period, the investigator, the military intelligence, they asked me, are you torturing us? Yes. So, you know, normally they put us not to having a good sleep and keep asking the questions. And one night, and one of them, they asked me, okay, you now better go to sleep. And I said, no, you better finish your questions. Because not only my family members, but also yours are waiting for us. So let's finish right now. And I don't want to sleep. Something like that. So back and forth, they arch me to sleep, and I keep asking me questions, so and so. And after a couple of minutes, they ask me, okay, are you torturing us? So something like that.
Sakthi, you have not been arrested?
Should I say fortunately or unfortunately?
But is that something that you worry about, or it doesn't come into your...
Well, but look at the superheroes. Would you recommend me to be in prison somehow? I'm quite afraid of the Australian immigration, though. But aside from that, Indonesia has gone through a long history of authoritarian government where people got imprisoned for saying what they're saying, no matter what medium that they choose to deliver their message, whether it is journalism or even poetry, novels, cartoon, all different kinds of mediums that people are using to express themselves. And today we are experiencing we have been blessed with democracy, with larger space to speak out. So yes, I do not expect myself to be arrested anytime soon, but we need to really watch ourselves very closely, because there are ways that government can do to sort of make things up, to make people's life more difficult than it's already is. Many things, war and terror, like Peter is mentioning, security act, law on security, law on internet security, law on pornography. Yeah. For instance, saying. All different kinds of things that the government can make up for to sort of limit, not necessarily arresting or stopping you at first instant, but
making it
terrorizing
harder.
You and making you feel afraid and making you censor yourself. Since 1970s, and I'm talking in my context as a comedian and media censorships that I face, since the 70s, we have what we call in Indonesia SARA, the SARA, or ethnicity, religion, race, and political groups. Those are the four taboos. They're not supposed to be violated, which means you're not supposed to talk about religion publicly, you're not supposed to talk about race and ethnicity publicly, and you're not supposed to ridicule political groups publicly. And despite of the 99-year 2000 reform and the new democracy that we are experiencing, that very law is still alive and valid, and it has turned into many regulations, including broadcasting regulation, which means that I cannot talk about sex on TV, I cannot talk about religion on TV, I cannot talk about my own experience as Arab descent community on TV. The only thing left that I can talk about perhaps is refrigerator.
And so, well, I know Raphael's looking for some kitchen appliances. just on that, Thida, when Peter was talking about how governments are using the war on terrorism as a means of curtailing freedom of speech, I saw you nodding quite strongly. Is that your experience? Just talk to us about that.
That's my area of concern also. I really want to protect the free speech under the title of the hate speech or the terrorism. A lot of our privacy and the free speech might be endangered. That's always been my concern.
Yeah.
And even whatever I do believe, it's, when we talk about insecurity, the one who feel so much in insecure could do the violence to the others. So sometimes we should look at the insecurity. It's not from our sides, it's from the other sides.
Yes.
Why they are in that kind of feeling of insecurity. It will solve some of the problems.
So, I mean, that's probably quite a good segue into censorship. And we talked to Saktiar about self-censorship. Can I ask our panel, do you care about censorship? Or I guess to Rafael, it's almost like a red rag to a bull.
Yes, of course. But the worst form of censorship is not even the one you find in the media, is the one you find in society. And the sources you come into contact with. Quite often, for instance, I will get tips on stories on things happening to people that have been have had their rights violated, but they will say, well, but don't quote me on this. I said, well, you suffered. If you don't want to stand up, then I will not do anything for you. And to break through that, even in my own experience, investigating abuses quite often, because corruption is so open in the country, so transparent, and the abuses are so in our faces, quite often one gets taken aback because you expect to dig deeper, to get into the stories. To give you an idea, last September, I found out that government death squads, police death squads, and criminal investigation groups had executed over 100 young people in 5 months, within 5 months, in just one area of the capital. And all those executions took place in broad daylight with children in front of a school in a square. All with bullets to the heads. And when I wrote the story, it took me days to say, but how can this be true?
Yeah.
And I had the pictures. And I had, and all of that, and I was only able to write about it because in one of the executions, the bullet hit a 7 or 8 year old child. Mm-hmm. And so you deal with that level of violence, and people are still afraid of talking about it because they said, no, the executioners live among us. We know them. And we know their houses and how they threaten us.
Yes.
And we don't want to talk about it to fear reprisals, for fear of reprisals, because more people can get killed. And that's when you ask yourself, how many people does silence save, you know?
Peter?
You know, it's interesting. I mean, one of the things that supposed to happen with the digital revolution is that Twitter and Facebook, social media, is supposed to open up the kind of space for people to give you that kind of information, to speak out, to expose a lot of these wrongs, these human rights abuses. But what I experienced, what I saw, not personally, but what I saw is that often exactly what Rafael was talking about is the easiest way of shutting the whole thing down. Doesn't matter how sophisticated governments think they need to be in censoring the internet, all you have to do is bang up a couple of the key activists, the most vocal spokespeople on social media, and you can pretty much shut it down. There'll always be corners where it leaks out, but you can really close down the conversation.
But you can also use it the other side, can't you, as part of a grassroots campaign?
You can, but here's the thing. I mean, let's go back to Egypt and my experience. The first prison I was in, I was alongside some extraordinary characters, the leaders of the secular leaders who organised the protests that toppled Hosni Mubarak on January 25th of 2011, guys like Alaa Abdel Fattah, Ahmed Meher. Alaa is one of the most extraordinary characters I've ever met. An independent character, a blogger, very, very charismatic, incredibly smart. There was guys like Ahmed Meher and Mohamed Adel, the leaders of the April 6th movement. Ahmed Doma, who is a poet and activist. All of these guys were in prison alongside us. They're still there. They're still in prison. And although it's possible as we saw in Egypt, for social media to create this kind of grassroots movement.
Yeah.
Do you think there's much of a movement now?
No.
It's all but disappeared.
Okay, Thida, with you as a writer, how important is the internet, the technology, getting your story out?
Well, it's now more and more important in this kind of the new era of technology. But I'm afraid the readership, the electronic readership, it's more and more like superficial, and it's just, you know, the very pretty much intermittent commitment to their readings through the digital era. It's quite dangerous. That's the way I have a very big concern, because, you know, it's people still have weapons to explore what's going on through media, but what we didn't explore enough is what people feel, what people think. It's not just through the journalists, it's not just through the media. That's why we still do need literature.
Yes.
To learn about how people feel, how people think. It's more important, and it cannot be traced that much in the digital media.
Rafael, what proportion of Angola would be on the internet?
Actually, it's quite small. One, because much of the country does not have functional electricity anyway, in spite of being one of the richest countries in terms of natural resources and the second largest oil producer in Africa. But what you have, which can be very effective, is that those who have internet and care are quite good at distributing the message. As we say, the bush telegraph is more efficient than the internet itself or any other medium of communication. The problem exactly is that bush telegraph has also been captured by the government because of its ability to broadcast fear in society. And that's what needs to be addressed, so that, like when I wrote this story about the executions, for the first time I wrote a story that people really went against it. Because they said, no, they're criminals and the government is right. So the only time people went on my page to comment in favor of the government in large numbers was to defend the executions, as the criminals are good as dead, when there was no evidence that these young people were criminals anyway. So that is what needs to change, is the perceptions and the way. But it's not the mean itself that delivers the message. It's the ability to enable people to feel that they need to share the information, and then they will do the rest, regardless of how internet is widespread or not.
I asked Thida about young activists in Angola. Are there young people coming through as passionate as you and who want to change things like you?
Yes. Just recently in June, the government released 17 of them who were convicted of attempting to overthrow the president by smoking him out of his palace, by burning tires in the palace, because they were reading a Jean Sharp book. They were discussing at a bookstore, these young people, how they would adapt Jean Sharp's theories of nonviolence into the Angolan context. And they were arrested on the spot, spent a year in jail, and were convicted in the end for setting up as a criminal association and for rebellion. They were reading a book. So you have passionate people, but they will pay the ultimate price for daring even to think. So as an Angolan writer put it, now to think is a crime in Angola.
Yeah. You know, the amount of experience we've got up here on this stage, and I'd like to end on something relating to hope, and I'm just wondering, let's say, start with you, Thida, the hope you had when you were locked in jail, solitary confinement, or you were sentenced to 20 years, what was your hope then, and is your hope for your country now travelled along a trajectory? Have you got more hope?
Well, my hope is every single citizens or the people of my country should be independent, free from every bad behavior or the attitudes, everything. So it's not just simply to knock down the bad governments, just to have a better citizenship for the country. So yeah. Right now, well, it's on its way, but not that much promising yet, because you know people of our country has been trained under a series of military governments how to do violence. That's all. So people are still struggling to keep themselves free from this kind of the old-fashioned training. So they're still struggling.
So what needs to change so that you and I aren't sitting on this stage in 5 years having exactly the same conversation?
Well, it's for me, I never ever think the prisons itself cannot change myself. And only the Vipassana meditation, the Buddha's teaching, the practice of meditation changed me a lot to look for not only freedom from the prisons, but also freedom from freedom to keep my own authority and freedom to the true freedom, I might say. Yeah.
Peter, hope is a powerful emotion, isn't it? And I think you said at one stage you were trapped in a struggle between hope and despair, mm-hmm. A tug of war between two fundamental but contradictory human urges. What is your hope?
Well, I'm going to say something quite radical here. I'm, you know, for all of the depressing kind of topics of conversation, for all of the awareness of human rights abuses, of atrocities and so on, the thing that I hope for is that we actually continue on the current path, and that's because if you look at the sweep of human history, if you look at Africa, Southeast Asia, for example, okay, Middle East, maybe there's still a bit of a problem there, but across those, Africa, yeah. Latin America, where I've worked, if you wind the clock back to about to the 70s, 60s, 70s and 80s, what you had, all of those three regions awash with violence. In Africa, there was civil wars in Angola and Mozambique and Zimbabwe and Somalia. Of course, there's still conflict in Somalia. There was the genocide in Rwanda. Congo is still, there was a massive war in Congo. Now we have ongoing conflict in the Congo. It's radically reduced. We have conflict in Somalia. That's an ongoing running sore in South Sudan. But right across Africa, the level of violence has over time has radically has reduced. In Southeast Asia, Vietnam was a mess. Burma, there's been real crisis. Now there's still problems there, but overall it's reduced dramatically.
So you're saying
in Indonesia,
we need to be patient.
We need to understand that over time, in terms of human history, things are improving. What we have to understand is that this is a trajectory that every single human rights abuse, every single person who is unjustly imprisoned, who is murdered, is an affront to all of us.
Yeah.
And as long as we keep understanding that, as long as we keep pushing forward, I think that there is a chance, never that we will reach perfect human rights, but that things will improve, that there will be blips. Middle East at the moment is a big blip. But overall, I actually think that if you step back a moment and look at it, there is tremendous reason for hope that this trajectory will in fact continue and it will be better off.
I like that view. Saktia, your country, what's your hope for Indonesia?
My hope for Indonesia is that women will have more choice, including becoming a comedian, because for women to be able to stand and laugh and ask people to laugh with them, that is as powerful statement as we can get, because, I mean, Indonesia, don't get me wrong, although it's a new democracy, I'm very proud of its advancement and also improvement. But for women to be able to laugh, it challenged all different kinds of authorities against women, against patriarchy, against themselves. And if I can pray sincerely that one of the children of Islamic extremist group anywhere in this world, in Middle East, in Indonesia, anywhere in this world, please God, let one of them grow up to be a comedian. That will change everything.
Beautiful commentary, beautiful commentary. Not only do I think you're saying it's a powerful statement, but I think you've shown how comedy can be such a powerful tool. Rafael, last word to you. You've got elections, I think, next year, Angola, 2017. Yes. What's your hope there?
Not much about the elections. We have the same president for for 37 years and the same ruling party for 40 years. And the electoral law gives the president the sole control of the whole process. So my hope is that people will change their mindset and find ways of removing him even with that law in place, which gives him full control of our lives. But more importantly, as I see it, for instance, I've been able to convince my friends from the intelligence who regularly pay me visits that my vegan food actually is quite good. And if they like my cooking, I think they can also like my ideas.
Aww. You just need the appliances. Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together.
Thank you.